I'm not getting ducked in a pimp ring. I believe what I speak. And if you need proof, just keep watching. Standing, giving God praise. Turn your Bibles to the book of Genesis, chapter 6. Can't stop, won't stop, part 2 on this morning. Can't stop, won't stop, part 2. Turn your Bibles to the book of Genesis, chapter 6. I won't be before you very long on this morning, but I pray that the word will empower you and encourage you. Can't stop, won't stop. In the book of Genesis, chapter 6, we began reading with verse number 9, very familiar passage. We're going to bring it to you from a 21st century standpoint of revelation. The Bible says in verse number 9 in the 6th chapter of Genesis, this is the account of Noah and his family. Noah was a righteous man, blameless among the people of his time. He walked faithfully with God. Noah had 3 sons, Shem, Ham, and Zephon. Now the earth, verse 11, now the earth was corrupt in God's sight and was full of violence. Yes, I'm reading the Bible, but it sounds like I'm reading the Chronicle. The earth was corrupt in God's sight and full of violence. Verse 12, God saw how corrupt the earth had become, for all the people on the earth had corrupted their ways. Looks like I'm seeing a story from CNN. Yeah. In verse 13, so God said to Noah, I'm going to put an end to all people, for the earth is filled with violence. Because of them, I'm surely going to destroy them and the earth. In conclusion, verse 14, so make yourself an ark of cypress wood. Make rooms in it and coat it with pitch inside and out. Take your seats and declare, can't stop, won't stop. Can't stop, won't stop. God here is giving Noah a vision, a dream to build an ark. God is doing his part by giving Noah an assignment, by giving Noah a purpose, by giving Noah something to accomplish. And I pray this morning, when you woke up, you did not wake up aimlessly, but you woke up because you had a purpose and a destiny on your life. I pray this morning that you realize that God didn't simply wake you up for the mere fact of you existing here on planet Earth, but God woke you up because he had a purpose and assignment for your life. God gave Noah a vision. God gave Noah a dream to build an ark. God did his part, but watch this, church. Noah had to maintain a can't stop, won't stop attitude to achieve it. We got to stop being excuse makers. We got to stop being on the sideline, and we got to understand that when God calls us out, when God gives us purpose, when God gives us assignment, we have to do our part by maintaining a can't stop, won't stop attitude. In the 9th grade, you have to make your mind up, no matter what I have to do, I'm going to get out of high school. In college, you make your mind up, no matter what I got to do, I'm going to graduate from college. You have to have a can't stop, won't stop attitude. Nothing is going to happen for you sitting on the sidelines, hoping and praying. Faith without works is dead. You got to get involved in the aspect and the affairs of your own life. Can't stop, won't stop. God gave the assignment, said, build the ark. Now Noah got to make his mind up, I'm going to build the ark. Right. Watch this. When Noah made his mind up, he's going to build the ark, he had to realize that building the ark was going to be a process. Motley, come here. Come up here. Building the ark was going to be a process. As I was preparing this text, I thought of an illustration, Stanley. I thought of an illustration at the genesis of this ministry that I thought worthy of repeating right now. There are seven steps of the process. Lay down. The first step, I love how obedient and faithful he is. He didn't question, he didn't look, he didn't sat down on a polo, he just jumped down. Okay. Laying down is where you receive the gift, the vision. When we're laying down, it gives God an opportunity to speak to us. Remember, it was chaos and corruption in the land. We can't hear from God in the midst of all the stuff we're hearing and seeing. So God has to put us in a position where we're laying down, where we can hear from God. We're in a position where we can see God, in a position where we can focus on God. So it starts with us laying down. And when we're laying down, we can hear from God. So what Satan does, he doesn't mind you laying down, doing nothing. He wants all of us to be in this position, laying down, hearing from God, and doing nothing. So he puts a foot on us to hold us down. He presents us with a different message than what God is saying, because Satan is afraid that once you hear from God, you'll sit up. Now, see, when you sit up here, now you're in a position to see. Look out. Put your hands like this here. Look out. Now you can see what God is calling you into. You can see what God has purpose for your life. So what Satan does here, while you're trying to see God, he gets in your way and reminds you of everything you've gone through. He reminds you of all your mistakes. He reminds you of all the people that have failed you, hurt you, and let you down. But he don't want you looking into your future. He wants you to get stuck in your presence. He wants to remind you of all the black men in your family that's been locked up and hooked up and messed up to sidetrack you. Because once you start looking out, now you see the unlimited potential that you possess. Because if you keep looking out, then you begin to get up. And once you get up, now you're in a position to start actually activating the purpose God has on your life. So hear what Satan tries to do is he tries to trip you up, he tries to set you up, he tries to push you down. And even if he push you down, fall down for a second, you got to make your mind up. A good man, a righteous man may fall down seven times, but yet he gets the enemy's worst nightmare is for a man or a woman of faith to get knocked down and get back up with a can't stop, won't stop attitude. Because once I get up, now I'm in position. I'm not laying down, I'm not sitting up, but now I'm in position to start doing something. And at first I have to walk slow. Walk slow. But I'm still making progress. So now what the enemy does while you're walking slow, he tells you, you ain't doing nothing. You ain't going nowhere. Ain't nothing much about you, but you're still making progress. 3 years ago, at the most important meetings with high-ranking officials, I would be at the back of the room if I'm lucky enough to be in the room. And no one knew my name. Now I get personal invitations to not just sit at the front of the room, but now I'm on a platform. But But while you're making slow progress, the devil tries to make you think you're not doing nothing, so you'll stop. But because if you keep making slow progress, you look back and the Lord has brought me a mighty. The Lord has brought me a mighty. So now, after moving slow, now I'm ready. I want you, don't hurt yourself. Now, okay, I want you, I'm going to sue me. Jump off the stage and run. Jump and run. Now run. And that's the position I'm trying to get all believers in, that you lay down, hear from God, you sit up and see what God has, and then you get up and you start making progress. And don't try to move too fast, too soon, because if you build it too fast, it may not last. Step by step by step by step, and then momentum will have you going fast, and you'll get to your destiny with a can't stop, won't stop attitude. So Noah had to trust God in a very uncomfortable position. All around him is chaos. Uh-huh. But I don't look at it as chaos. I look at God using Noah to prove that I got to eliminate my excuse of why I can't succeed. Noah was living in a generation where the Bible says men were doing whatever they felt like doing. It sounds like today. Yeah. Yet the Bible labels Noah as being an upright and righteous man in the midst of it all. So stop telling me that I don't have no choice. I'm boxed in. I'm just being like everybody else. You don't have to be like anybody. You can make your mind. I dare every black man and brown man in here to stand up right now. I want to talk to my brothers real quick. Every black and brown man, stand up right now. Okay, well, watch this. Watch this. When the Bible says in the same book of Genesis that when God created man, he took dirt. He took mud, which is insignificant. Dirt, mud has no significance. He took something that was insignificant, dirt and mud, and he put it in a lump. He looked at himself, and he began to carve out this dirt and made an image that looked like him. He said, okay, now I have a man. No, but that's not enough. Then he opened up the man's mouth, and God said, he was putting some God inside of something that started out being insignificant. You may have started out being insignificant, but as soon as you got some God in you, now you became created in the image of God. And I read nowhere in the text where God changed his mind. God never said, God never sucked the God out of you. So you should not be operating like a dog or a thug or a gangster. If you call him for G, don't be G for gangster, be G for godly. God never changed his mind about who you were. The enemy wants to trip you up and set you up, but God called you in his image. So I want to stir you up to make you believe that you are worth fighting for.
Amen. Amen.
Don't give up on you. Can't stop, won't stop attitude is about you not giving up on you. Because when you give up on you, you're giving up on the God in you.
That's right.
Watch this. I told the 830 crowd that there are four steps or four things you have to be concerned about to have this attitude of can't stop, won't stop. Number one aspect is you have to have discernment. Discernment. Noah did not call Noah. God called Noah.
All right.
God spoke something. God inspired something. Well, watch this, watch this. I'll never forget on Aptex Drive, 1201 Aptex, there was a large area of concrete and an empty warehouse storefront. I stood inside of this empty space with Sister Bridget Williams. I said, Mother people, there's about three or four of us. They said, Pastor, why are we here? I said, because God spoke a Greenhouse International Church. And we're about to redirect our whole life and invest in a Greenhouse International Church. Well, the first month's rent was $5,500 with no members. But I had a God-inspired vision.
All right.
And years later, you are a byproduct of spiritual discernment, of in an empty place with nothing but a concrete slab and four walls, hearing God say a Greenhouse International Church where hurt and broken people can be made whole. I had no idea then about no more bloodshed. I had no idea then about domestic violence. I had no idea about marching and protesting. I had no idea about any of the stuff I'm doing today, but God saw it already. So he said, create a greenhouse, a place where you can take something that's been damaged and give it the potential to grow and reach its full potential. Discernment. It must start with discernment. But you can't hear from God if you're hearing from everybody else.
Amen.
You need discernment.
Yes, Lord.
And sometimes God will tell you, leave them with the donkeys so you can hear from me. And not only do you need discernment, but men, we need discipline.
Come on.
I should have gave you a warning. You won't shout today. You won't shout, but you'll leave better. Yeah. I'm too tired to make you shout, but I'm obligated to make you better.
Yes, Lord.
You need discipline. And discipline is the ability to stay focused, the ability to operate with a spirit of excellence, the ability to operate with honor. And people say, Pastor, you don't hold your facial expressions well because I hate disorder. I hate dysfunction. When things are not going with the spirit of excellence, it frustrates the spirit of God in me, because when God created the world, he created the world with honor. God, you don't, the moon just don't happen to stand there, just show up. The moon shows up at an organized time. The sun comes out at an organized time. And the moon and the sun don't fight on who won't show up this time. The moon and the sun operate in order, because when God created the world, he created the world with order. So we must have discipline to know that we can't touch everything. The problem with Eve was she did not have the discipline. If God says don't touch it, then don't touch it. You cannot be great without discipline. You can pray all you want. You can fast all you want. You can join every ministry and every church, but if you don't have discipline, you will never be anything except a sounding brass. You will never reach your full potential without discipline. If you don't have discipline over your finances, you will always stay broke with how much money you make. If you don't have discipline over your body, you will always be in some kind of jam and some kind of confusion. If you don't have discipline over your mind, you will always be tossing from here and there, always mad, upset, and angry. We must have discipline. If we don't have discipline, we cannot expect for God to give us greatness.
Yes, Lord.
That's good. That's good.
Because discipline allows me to stop blaming the devil.
Come on, come on.
Yes.
Come on,
it's easy to blame the devil.
Come on, press.
Blame mama and them. Blame daddy not being there. But if you had discipline, you could overcome mama, you could overcome daddy not being there. If you have discipline, you can overcome every obstacle thrown at you in life. If you had discipline, you will have a can't stop, won't stop attitude.
Come on, man, I got press this morning.
And then I have to have a daring spirit.
All right.
Spirit of faith.
All right.
Stop telling me what you ain't never done.
Yeah.
Wait, nobody, ain't my, anybody in my family ever done that? You be the one.
Yeah.
You be the frontier.
Yeah.
You be the pioneer. You be the one to break the curse. You be the one to rewrite the history.
Yeah.
You be the one to uproot that seed, that negative tree, and you plant a new tree, a new seed.
Yes, Lord. Yes,
you have
Lord.
To be daring.
Come on, man of God.
Faith is not operated by sight. Faith is operated by belief. I have to believe that when God woke me up this morning, he woke me up on purpose, with a purpose. God gave me power. God gave me authority. And when I say I don't mean I as in me, I mean I as a believer. So you got to operate knowing that God is able, and you cannot win in life unless you're daring. You will never win being afraid. David beat Goliath because David had the faith to face Goliath. His brothers were powers on the sideline talking about how big Goliath was. And David said, the heck with how big he is. I got faith. I can take the giants in my life down. Never in life you have to have the faith that no matter what the obstacle is, no matter the degree plan, no matter the hurdle, you have to have the faith that I'm daring enough to accomplish it.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
You have to believe.
Yes, Lord.
You have to believe. And then you have to have determination to stick to it. Determination.
That's good, Pastor.
You know how many great people never became great because they quit on themselves?
My God. My God.
God never promised me it will be easy.
Yes.
Now, I gotta admit, he didn't tell me it would be this hard.
Come on. Jesus.
But he never promised me it would be easy.
Yeah.
But he said, son, if you don't quit.
Don't quit.
I'll make your name great.
Don't quit.
If you don't quit, I'll do something great, do you?
Don't quit.
And he's not just talking to me. If you don't quit, if you won't quit, I'm promising you, I'm living proof. God will do something great to you if you just have determination to keep getting up, determination to keep going, determination that if God said it, I believe it.
Yes. You gotta make it to the other side.
Yes.
Watch this. Look at Genesis chapter 6, verse 14. Watch this.
Jesus.
God told Noah to build
an ark.
Uh-huh. That's discernment.
Uh-huh.
God spoke.
Uh-huh.
Noah heard it. God's word.
Come on, man of God.
Faith comes by
hearing.
We have to stand on what God said.
Yeah, 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 yeah,
if God said it,
yes, Lord,
God has to back up his word.
Yeah.
And if God said it to you, that means God has to back you up, because if God gave you his word and God has to honor his word, yeah, so you stand in God's word, God has to therefore honor you, because as long as you're standing in God's word with a can't stop, won't stop attitude, whatever God told you has to become your reality.
Yes, Lord.
Amen.
Yes, Lord.
God said it.
God said it.
So that means I have to listen more and look less.
Uh-huh. Jesus.
Because when God spoke to Noah, there was chaos.
Come on, man of God.
Violence.
Come on.
Ungodliness in the land.
Yeah.
And if Noah would have kept looking at what was going on, he could have never heard from God.
Yeah.
Stop looking so closely at the pulpit.
Jesus.
Stop looking so closely at personalities and talented and gifted,
yes,
people, and start listening to what God is.
Jesus!
This season, I can care less about how gifted you think I am and how talented you think I am. I want to live with character and integrity.
Jesus!
I don't want to just be known as another gifted preacher. I want to be known as a man whose word meant something, whose lifestyle was worth following after. I want to be Christ-like.
Come on!
Stop looking.
Yeah.
Listening.
Come on, man of God.
Because Satan will throw booby traps.
Yes, he will.
He'll throw booby traps. So you'll start looking. See, Eve was okay with the conversation until Satan said, look at it.
Yeah.
Look how shiny it is.
Yes.
Look how pretty it is.
Yeah.
It smells good. Come on, can we be transparent? You've been somewhere, and something just walks by, and you be like, you try not to look, and you try in your heart. And if you don't have discipline, you're going to be taking a bite of the fruit, and the next thing you know, you're no longer enjoying the fruit of the promised land. Now you're struggling and suffering, because remember, after they messed up, the easy life was no longer easy. Now it was hard. So ask yourself, is it worth it? You may, for a little while, enjoy begging with the good hand, but is it worth it?
Come on, man of God.
What will it cost you?
Yeah.
This week I sat in a capital murder trial where four young men traded their lives for a pair of Jordan tennis shoes.
Jesus!
Four young men traded their future, their manhood, for a pair of tennis shoes. Was it worth it?
Is it worth it? My God.
We have to listen more.
Yes.
And look less.
Yeah.
When God speaks to men and women in times of trouble, what he's doing is raising up a new generation of leaders.
All
right. See, what others see right now as violence, what others see right now as chaos, I hope this don't sound morbid or twisted, but I saw it as God's giving me an opportunity to rise up. So now in the midst of chaos, in the midst of murder, in the midst of all kind of foolishness, God has raised up a little bitty boy from Fifth Ward, and now the town leaders, now the city leaders, now the country leaders are saying, he's one of us, he's a leader, because I had an attitude of can't stop, won't stop. Has it always been easy? Heck no. Have I been knocked down? Yes. But I realized I got to get back up, because watch this. When God told Noah to build the ark, Noah gave an invitation to the whole wide world to come. And you know how many folks showed up? Come help me out, Bill. Come here real quickly. But in real life, you're not here. I'm by myself. Tomorrow, everything.
Yeah, we
done. I'm a toolbox at home, and no hammers and nothing, Pastor. I had to borrow everything, but this is what happened. Noah started building. Even though there was nobody there to help him, he started building. It's okay. He didn't say it was going to be easy. Just now sit down. So Noah started building. Because Noah saw an opportunity to do something for God. So Noah said, I can't stop because God has assigned me to build the ark. And even though no one's going to build it with me, even though no one's going to help me, Noah started. Building. I got. Let's be chaotic. Because Noah by himself. He ain't no help. He just started.
He didn't even know how.
And he was building something he had never even seen before.
Yeah, he had never did that before.
What God is doing in your life right now, you ain't never seen. Your mama ain't never seen. Your dad ain't never seen. So why are you taking the advice of your mom and dad about something ain't nobody ever seen before? How can you tell me what I can't do and what God told me to do? We ain't never seen before.
Oh, you ain't never did it.
So Noah just started building. Noah, in verse 17, began to trust God that God knew what was next. God said, it's going to flood, and it ain't never rained before. It was dry, yet God told Noah to build an ark. So Noah realized, if God say, build it, I got to keep
building. Keep building.
I wonder how many of you will get a hammer in your hand and a box of nails, and when you hear from God, you won't question what God says. I know it ain't never rain, but if God says build it, you gotta start. I know nobody in your family ever been debt free, but if God says it's possible, you gotta start. I know nobody in your family ever been drug free, but if God said it, you gotta start. I know nobody in your family ever got married and stayed married, but if God said it, you gotta. I know ain't nobody in your family ever became a doctor, but you. I know ain't nobody in your family ever did what you trying to do, but you gotta have a can't stop, won't stop attitude. Grab your hammer and just start.
Jesus! Jesus! My God!
And the reason Noah can keep going.
Come on, man of God.
Because verse 18 says God had a covenant.
Come on.
With Noah.
He made a covenant with
God. This is a partnership.
Jesus.
With Noah. So what God was telling Noah.
Come on, preacher.
Noah, you can do all things.
Yes.
Just keep on building.
Yes.
God was telling Noah. With God, nothing is impossible. Yes. Just keep on
building.
God was telling Noah that the good work I began in you, I won't stop. Just keep on. Young black man, just keep on. Single mother, just keep on. I know you've been locked up, but keep. I know you've been on that stuff, but keep. I know you've been through those stuff, but keep. Because God made you a promise, and God made you a covenant. If you keep on building, if you keep on hammering, if you keep on going, God said, if you don't stop, if you don't quit, I'm going to bless you. So Noah,
Jesus,
just kept on,
yes, Lord,
building.
Yes, Lord.
And I'm sure by the time Noah got to verse 22,
my God, he was in covenant,
when the Bible says, without question, Noah just simply did what God said to do.
Yes.
Noah just kept on. His friends didn't show up. His co-workers didn't show up. Nobody showed up. But God didn't call them. God called you. And God didn't tell them what he told you. So why are you depending on folks that weren't in the conversation? God has seen what you need when you need what you need when you need what you need. But right now you gotta keep on. And if you keep on building, God will keep on adding, and God will keep on increasing. God said you gotta build, because if you don't build when the flood comes, if you don't build when the storms come, if you don't build when the danger comes, then you and your children, and your children's friends, and your children's dog, and your children's cat, gonna lose their life. And I hope you realize by now, We're living in dangerous times. I hope you realize by now, when you turn on your news and you see murder here and murder there, if you don't start billing, murder gonna be at your door next. Don't you think you're exempt from what's going on in the land? If I was you, I'd get my hammer and I'd start building right now. If I was you, I'd get my hammer and I'd start building right now. I'm sure there were times when Noah wanted to quit, but Noah just kept on building. Why would Noah keep on building? Because Noah realized that was too much at stake. I can't quit now. I gotta keep on building. There's too much at stake. If I put my hammer down, it's not just about me. If I put my hammer down, I'm letting down everybody that God assigned to my life. If I put my hammer down, I'm letting everybody down who God assigned to the ark. If I put my hammer down, I'm letting my future down. If I put my hammer down, I'm letting God down. Because I didn't call me to build an ark. It was God that said, build the ark. So if I put my hammer down, it's no longer even about me. If I put my hammer down, I'm telling God you wasn't good enough to give me what I need to build the ark. I'm sure Noah wanted to quit. But every time Noah got ready to quit, Noah thought about why he started in the first place. When it gets hard in your life, you gotta think about why you started in the first place. When your marriage get hard, think about why you said I do in the first place. When your situation get muddy, think about what God said in the first place. When in the midst of chaos, in the midst of danger, God called you to do something great, and you will never do anything great without great attack, without great adversary, without great, great, great hurdles. But if you willing to keep going, God said, I'll make you great. If you just keep on going, keep on hammering, keep on nailing, you'll look up and a 2x2 and a 2x2 come together, and now you got an angle, now you got an angle, now you got a cornerstone. Uh-oh, we can build a cornerstone now. And you do know what the cornerstone is Jesus. And once I build the cornerstone, once I have Jesus, now everything will fall in place. So Noah kept on building, because Noah heard God say, if you don't build it, then they won't make it. If you don't build it, they won't survive. And you can't wait till the test to start studying. You gotta prepare right now. You gotta start building right now. I dare you to get your hammer. I dare you to take out your toolbox. And whatever God told you to build, just start building. It may be slow progress, but just keep on hammering. Nobody may recognize you, but just keep on hammering. Nobody may appreciate you, but just keep on hammering. Because you'll look up and all of a sudden, the cornerstone be connected to something else, and something else be connected to something else. Now you got yourself an ark. But what's an ark? It's an ark of safety. Because I need safety. I need protection. I need covering. I need Jesus. So I'm telling you right now, don't stop. Can't stop. I'm telling you right now, if you just keep going, God's going to do something great in your life. If you just keep going, God's going to use you, because God took no to extend mankind. If Noah wouldn't have built the ark, you and I wouldn't be here right now. But because Noah kept hammering, it gave God somebody he can use in dangerous times. You know we live in dangerous times, but can God use you? Can God trust you? Can God speak to you? And when you hear from God, can you make your mind up? Can't stop, won't stop. I dare you right now to make your mind up. No matter how heavy, no matter how hard, no matter how difficult, I've made my mind up. I won't stop, can't stop. Can't stop on me and can't stop on God.
You